I'm Deb Logerquist, and I'm here for the Sevastopol Historical Society to talk with one of our veterans from the area. It is June 3rd, 2013, and I'm very pleased to have Jim Huhta with me here this morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
We'll just start maybe with a little general information about your background, if you want to let us know where you were born and grew up and some of your early experiences.
I was born in Chicago, 1933. You can figure the age. I went into the service in 1954. Most of my life I spent in Wisconsin, Wauwatosa area, and I've been up here since 1972, on and off, visiting, and then Joanne and I retired up here in 1998. So.
Well,
it's
good.
Utopia to me. I spent 28 years with the Air Force, almost 5 years active, and 23 on reserve duty, active reserve to the extent that it was probably 15 to 20 hours a week. So,
now, what led you to join the Air Force? Was there family history or?
No, I was the first one in my family to go into the service. It was 1950, I was 17, and I was going to college in the Korea. I was graduated from high school in 1950, June 7, and the Korean War started later that month. I went off to university and the war broke out and I was concerned about the draft. And I did not know what to do, and I asked my dad, I said, what do I do? And he said, well, finish your university studies and then see what happens. So in order to avoid the draft, I joined the Reserve Officer Training Corps.
The ROTC.
ROTC, and if I kept my grades up and behaved myself, then I would be deferred. I would get a classification that said you will not be drafted. But I had a commitment after 4 years. I was graduated in 1954, and in August of 54 I went into service with a 3-year commitment, which eventually extended to almost 5 years. I took a battery of tests my junior year, and they thought that I might be coordinated enough and able to fly airplanes. So I always had a love for airplanes from back in World War II and watching them fly overhead out of the Chicago area. So I decided, well, I'll try that. So in September, I was out in Arizona for the fall and the winter. I thought it was pretty nice. It was beautiful weather. And I had been in an airplane twice. I didn't know the left wing from the right, basically, but I jumped in this airplane. It was a brand new airplane made by Beechcraft, similar to a Bonanza for all you gearheads. And I flew that, and I was able to solo in about 8 hours and total of 40, and then they put me in a North American T-28 Trojan, which was about the size of a World War II fighter, and that was a lot of fun. I got 80 hours in that, and then I graduated from what they called primary flying school, and they sent me to multi-engine school in Lubbock, Texas. And we flew the old B-25, a twin-engine, piston-driven propeller airplane that, of course, the famous General Doolittle, at the time he was Lieutenant Colonel, took off from the Hornet and bombed Tokyo on April 18th of 1942. So I was there until September 15th of 55, and then I was graduated. And I was hoping for a flying slot. I was probably in close to top 10 or 15 of the class. But the Air Force decided they were going to send me to radar school.
Hmm.
And after radar school, in other words, radar school was on the ground, and you had a radar set in front of you, and you were supposed to drive these fighters back and forth to practice down in Florida. And I thought about that for a while, and I thought, I didn't go through 13, almost 14 months of doing all this stuff and then going up and not flying. So I signed up for advanced flying school. While down in Florida, there's this, that's called a Lockheed Shooting Star.
Mm-hmm.
There's two models. This is what they call the T-Bird or T-33. It's a trainer, two cockpits. The Air Force doesn't allow you to just take off and go like they used to.
Mm-hmm.
So they gave me an instructor. There were 21 of us in the class, and two of us, a good friend of mine and I, were the only ones who decided we would go and try to fly that thing after flying reciprocating propeller airplanes.
Mm-hmm.
And we were at the club, and we had a few Coca-Colas, and we decided, well, yes, let's do it. So Ed Brown and I decided that we would do it. I met my instructor, and he met his. Mine was a Lieutenant Dave Robinson. His was Lieutenant Jimmy Sato. And they were hard up for pilots to drive target aircraft in a racetrack. And the fighters would go at a 90-degree angle and practice in these Sabre jets. So Lieutenant Robinson gave me three takeoffs and three landings and six flame-out patterns where you pretend the engine is flamed out.
Mm-hmm.
And you've got to glide down and make a successful landing or an apparent successful landing. And then he said, okay, you're ready to go.
On your own.
So off I went. It was exciting, it was exhilarating, and I was pretty much scared, primarily because it has an ejection seat. And that rocket is sitting, you know, and it's going to shoot you out, and you had to remember to blow the canopy, and then you had to remember to do this. And it was a fear of the unknown. I didn't really understand the system. So when you taxied out, you had to pull the pins, and you had to show them to the crew chief.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're supposed to put them in a little canvas mm-hmm. pocket. Well, I did that, and I put them in the canvas pocket, and I taxied out, and then I took them out of the pocket, and I put them back in. I was afraid that suit was going to blow off on the ground, and I was going to wind up in the evergreens. So I flew that for about 7 months, mostly solo,
mm-hmm.
because they were so hard up for pilots, and I learned. Then my orders came through, and I had signed up for fighters, of course. Everybody wanted that. And I signed up for a twin-engine jet bomber, and I signed up for a night intruder airplane. And you had to have four choices, and the last choice I signed up was for helicopters.
Mm-hmm.
So you can guess what the Air Force gave me. I had all this propeller time and single engine and multi-engine, and they decided they'd put me to helicopter school. It's military intelligence is an oxymoron. So I went to helicopter school, and I flew the old Bell H-13, which was on the MASH show.
Mm-hmm.
Had that big bubble in front.
Mm-hmm.
That was a terrible, terrible experience. My wife was expecting, and I wasn't concentrating, and it took me half the size of a football field to...
Well, things are sort of backward from fixed wing.
Totally. Totally. I could talk for 10 hours on the rotor system on a helo. But after I finally got out of this little bubble machine, which I hated, I got into what is a Sikorsky H-19. It had the same engine as another. It was seven cylinders and 800 horsepower, and it was still underpowered. So after I graduated from helicopter school, they made me primarily a helicopter pilot, and I went overseas to Japan, Korea, and Formosa as a helicopter pilot, of course, in the 39th Air Rescue Squadron.
Oh, okay.
So I got over there, I believe about September, and I was a qualified. And it was December 7th, 1956, and I remember this so well because it's in the back of my mind. They blew the klaxon, the big horn, and there was a Lieutenant George Ullman and a Staff Sergeant Delbert Ray, who was a PJ, like a paramedic.
Okay.
Only he could jump out of airplanes or helos. Mm-hmm. And it seemed that a ship was sinking in west of Japan. Maybe you could.
Was it that last picture?
The last one, yeah. So George and I and Delbert took off in that helo there, and if I describe the picture for a moment, this is a pontoon response on the, it was a Grumman Albatross, an SA-16, and the squadron commander was on board. And the pilot was a guy named Major Ray Day. We called him Major Mayday Ray Day. You know what Mayday means?
Yes.
Okay. He was pretty excited. And they were circling overhead like a cap, in case something went wrong. Mm-hmm. And this ship was sinking. It had 31 people on board. 24 got off in a life raft, and this is an island. Mm-hmm. And seven of them couldn't get off the boat, and it was obviously going down fast. They were taking pictures, and as it progressed, the ship got lower and lower in the water. So George and Delbert and I can't take any singular credit, hovered, and if you look close, you can see a man holding another man, and we dropped a sling down and pulled up two at a time. I went over to shore, dropped them off, came back. George took the next two over the shore, back and forth, until we got all seven. Then we went back to the base and resumed our coffee break, and the old heart was...
Now, is that difficult to maintain your hover when you've got something swinging around underneath you there?
No.
When you're pulling up, or that's...
No. The problem was that we had a good hover capability because the wind is always better when it's on your nose, and you can probably see that
the wind is
kind of coming from this away or this away. The big problem, if you see the length of the blade from here to here, and you measure the blade from here to here, it looks like it's only a couple of feet from that mast. Well, if we hit the mast, that's it. Adios. That's why I was scared. My eyeballs were clicking at the mast and at the instruments, as was George's. We were pretty excited.
Mm-hmm. But a successful rescue, so that's...
We got all seven off and went back to the base and resumed our coffee. And then they gave me this certificate, and it says it was me. I was a first lieutenant at the time, and I was given the what they call the Winged Air Rescue Award emblem, and it was signed by none other than Igor Sikorsky.
Oh, wow!
There are a lot of these out here. Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of these certificates, but you had to do certain things to qualify. And the date is 7 December 1956, 15 years after Pearl Harbor. Mm-hmm. So they gave me a little teeny tiny thing to wear in my lapel. And that's the story of that.
Is that what the...
I'll show you later.
Oh, okay.
So about 2 weeks after we did this mission, the squadron photographer comes up to me and he says, "Here are some pictures you might like." And he had about a dozen like this, and he gave them to me. And I thought, well, you know, I put them away somewhere at home underneath a bunch of other pictures and stuff. And about 20 years ago, maybe 30, I pulled it out and I thought, well, I'll get it framed.
Mm-hmm.
And when I get scared of something, I kind of look at that picture and think, you know, it can't be that
bad. It's not
bad.
That bad.
So then after about 14 months in Japan, we went to Korea and Formosa, what they call Element. Three guys go over there with a helicopter, and
mm-hmm.
we had several rescues in Korea and one in Formosa. Then I went back and got reassigned to Louisiana as a base helicopter pilot. It was a fighter squadron base, and they were plopping in F-100 Super Sabres just all over the place. There was a new airplane, there was new pilots, and it was an interesting time down there.
Mm-hmm.
I pulled out probably, I don't know, 15, maybe 20 that had bailed out, and everything from a cotton field to the swamps.
Mm-hmm.
There was a tanker that threw number three propeller off. It goes 1, 2, 3, 4.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is not the tanker, but
right.
it threw number three off, and number three went into number four and then hopped across the wing, and their whole wing was on fire, and they crashed into the swamp.
Mm-hmm.
So they blew the whistle, and they called us, and we happened to have a radio on board that was tuned to the Louisiana State Patrol. I never got a ticket down there. it was a guy named Clem Bailey and I, drove up there in a helicopter, and we pulled these seven guys out of the swamp by hovering in a river because the trees were too tall.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So, and then I got out of the service and went to work for some Fortune 500 companies. And I had a 6-year commitment. I had four kids and a house and a big mortgage and a wife, and the Vietnam War was heating up. And I thought, well, golly, I did my almost 5 years active. And I knew they were going to call me up for Vietnam because I was a helicopter pilot and there weren't that many around. And it kind of felt like to me that it was maybe a little cannon fodder. I give those guys an awful lot of credit. I give the foot soldier, the Marine guys, the gravel crushers, all those, I give them the most credit because they had the toughest job.
Mm-hmm.
I sometimes sat in an air-conditioned office and, mm-hmm. and drove around. So I decided that since I had a primarily helicopter rating, that I would join the reserves, and I had to do it within 2 months, and then get checked out as a co-pilot on an old twin-engine troop carrier,
mm-hmm.
dropping paratroopers and things like that. So in 2 months, I got my qualification sheet as a co-pilot, and I took that piece of paper and I went to personnel and I said, please take me off my rating as a helicopter pilot and please put me on as a co-pilot on a C-119 flying boxcar, which they did. And then I flew those for 2,200 hours probably in about 10 years.
Where were you stationed then?
Pardon?
Where were you stationed during that time?
Oh, I was stationed in Milwaukee.
Oh, okay.
At the 440th, the famous 440th.
Oh, yes.
And I was basically home every night, except I was probably gone 30 to 35 weekends a year,
mm-hmm.
On a trip somewhere. This plane is known as a trash hauler. It hauls trash. It was a good airplane. And we got rid of the C-119 boxcars and we got the A model of the C-130. This is not an A.
Mm-hmm.
They came from Vietnam, and most times you took off with four engines as required, and most times you came back with just three. They were
mm-hmm.
they were just really beat up, but we had great maintenance, so they took care of it.
Mm-hmm.
And I flew this until 1982, when I retired and I got I have probably 2,000 hours in this machine, and I was, they decided I could be an aircraft commander, and all you are is a manager. You sit there and you keep the co-pilot and the navigator and the flight engineer and the load man, you keep them happy.
Mm-hmm.
Co-pilot sits over there and he pouts, so you give him a landing. Loadmasters maybe had too many colas and he wants to sleep, so you let him sleep. So then I retired in 1982. When I came up here, I joined the Civil Air Patrol. I'm medically disqualified, but I did have a friend in the Civil Air Patrol who owned his own airplane.
Okay. Just in case there are those that aren't familiar with the Civil Air Patrol, what are the duties and functions of that organization?
Well, it's search and rescue, primarily. And it's also educating aerospace data, and it's also having cadets and being enthusiastic and advocating aeronautical things. I was a member probably until last December, and there's only so much that I wanted to do. I wanted to be able to drive the airplane, but again, I was medically disqualified. But my friend who was in the CAP with me at Civil Air Patrol had his own airplane, so he let me do whatever I wanted.
Did the mission of the CAP change any after 9/11, or did it still stay primarily a search and rescue?
They got more intense, I would say. Mm-hmm. Civil Air Patrol got more intense. They're very strict, and they should be. A lot of the mission pilots have maybe 300, 400 hours, and they're safe. They have to be. They're given check rides. Mm-hmm. And they regularly go out, and I think the squadron here averaged about 200 hours flying a year, which is a lot.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And these are all volunteers. You buy your own uniform. Sometimes you have to buy your own gas.
Mm-hmm.
The maintenance is taken care of.
Mm-hmm.
And if you do anything wrong, you've got a stack of paper to fill out. So, you know, rule A is don't make a mistake, and rule B is follow rule A. Just don't make a mistake.
Yes, uh-huh.
And the guys here are quite qualified.
Mm-hmm.
And they would let me fly it at altitude, but anywhere near the ground, no. And I did not want to.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I just sat there, and maybe I was their comfort blanket. I like to think maybe I was their comfort blanket.
Their spare tire.
Yeah, I was a spare tire. And they'd ask me, so what do you think? And I would tell them what I thought from, you know, 28 years and almost 5,000 hours of flying time. So.
And there's no substitute for that experience, as, you know, Captain Sullenberger showed us.
Yes, he sure. It's one of my heroes,
mm-hmm.
Sully.
Mm-hmm.
Perfect.
Yes.
He did an absolutely perfect egg. Mm-hmm. Absolutely perfect. Totally.
Yeah.
I have seen, when we're talking about, I have seen a simulated computer images of everything that took from the from the flight recorders, the flight and the ground controllers, and.
But that was his experience to know to think about that, and that's where our military pilots, that training that you all get and the experiences you have are really invaluable. And were you ever tempted to go into this, civilian?
Yes,
airline
I worked for a very, very short period for Chicago Helicopter Airways. It was a political connection. Somebody knew somebody, and Chicago Helicopter Airways, the chief pilot called me up and said, where have you been? We've been looking for you. So I went down, and they put me in a big helicopter I had never flown before, bigger than that one.
Mm-hmm.
It weighed about 8,000 pounds, 9,000, and they took me around Midway. And said, okay. Then he took me back to his office and asked me a bunch of things. And I recall so well, he reaches down in his drawer and he pulls out a stack of applications this high. And he just pulled one out and he said, this person is a Navy pilot. He's got 3,000 hours of helicopter time. He said, how much do you have? I said, just under 1,000. He pulled another one. This is a Marine. pilot. He's got 5,000 hours of helicopters in the same helicopter we fly. But then he said, but do you want the job? I said, yes. Then I was offered another job in market research, which was what I studied in school mm-hmm. for. So I decided to leave the helicopter. They were highly subsidized by the government, and mm-hmm. I just went into civilian life for about mm-hmm. 5.5 years.
We had a real interesting career that a lot of pilots don't have, as far as you flew fixed wing, both prop and jet, and then you were in helicopters. So out of those three, which would you say you enjoyed flying the most? Is there a lot of difference in a jet versus a propeller plane?
Yeah, there's mm-hmm. less torque, it's quieter. The jets nowadays are so reliable. The biggest challenge to me was flying the helicopter. Mm-hmm. That thing had me driving it around instead of me driving mm-hmm. it. The Lockheed Shooting Star was pretty much point and it'll go.
Mm-hmm.
There was no torque to be concerned with mm-hmm. Engines. The C-130 was probably the second easiest. It's a lot of weight, and it was a lot of fun in this mm-hmm. machine too.
So did you do the in-air refueling with your C-130 or?
No, the ones we had were not mm-hmm. qualified. All we did was trained paratroopers mm-hmm. in Fort Benning, Fort McCoy, Fort Campbell, and Pope Field,
okay.
among others, or we would drop cargo. Mm-hmm. During the Vietnam, we would haul trash from wherever they sent us out to the West Coast, normally mm-hmm. out to San Francisco area, Travis Air mm-hmm. Force Base, or a Marine facility, I think it was down in San Diego. And we would haul passengers. One day I had, there were 26 generals who had 42 stars going to a conference in Phoenix from San Antonio, Texas. And they picked me to drive these 26 generals. So there were 1 star, 2 star, and I believe there was 1 3-star. And I flew with either 2 or 3 of the generals out of Milwaukee. And they were in the back and I was driving, and it didn't seem to bother them. I thought they'd maybe want to have somebody with maybe 10,000 hours of flying time to mm-hmm. drive these guys. But no, they and everything worked out fine.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So.
Well, I'd heard that the C-130s, if you had to fly them with just 2 engines, they were pretty airworthy.
Yes. You can lose an engine on this, and you can say, oh, let's see now. Which engine is it? Are you sure? Okay, let's take out the checklist, and let's go through it, blah, 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 and let's shut it down. And everybody, la, la, la. Take your time. I'm overemphasizing, mm-hmm. unless it's on takeoff, and then it's boom, 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 and that's it.
Mm-hmm.
It would fly on 3. The rules said that if you took off from California and you were over Utah and an engine failed and you could maintain altitude, over the mountains, of course, mm-hmm. or wherever, then you could fly all the way to home base, Milwaukee, for maintenance on 3 engines.
Mm-hmm.
But you had to declare an emergency before you landed in Milwaukee.
Mm-hmm.
So, you could fly all day on 3. Could you fly on 2? Yes, I think the Navy, who had P-3 Orions, had the same engines, would loiter when they were hunting for submarines. My kid brother was a navigator on a P-3 Orions,
mm.
which is a Lockheed Electra. They would feather the 2 outboards
mm-hmm.
and or shut down the two outboards to save fuel and just go on the two inboards.
Yeah.
And then when they came off of duty, then it was mandatory that they start the other two up and land on four.
Mm-hmm.
It would be kind of dumb to land on two when you had two good ones out there.
Right, right.
So.
Yeah. So, do you miss flying? Or you had enough hours to satisfy the...
I think I had enough hours to to satisfy me. I found other things to do that instead of 600 miles an hour, I rode a teeny tiny motorcycle at 28 miles an hour. Uh-huh. I drive a sailboat at 5 miles an hour. So I don't have the need for speed anymore.
Mm-hmm. No. Mm-hmm. Now, did any of your children follow you into the service or?
No.
No? No. So you were the only one that got the bug.
I'm the only one that, avoided the draft and subsequently went into all this. But I did have a love of aeronautics when I was in grade school. And it was predicated upon the war at the time. These airplanes would come over my house and I'd get up at 5:30 in the morning and they'd roar overhead and all these Grumman Hellcats and Stearmans and Volte vibrators and all these airplanes. So, but I built models and I drew pictures, but it never dawned on me that someday I would be able to do, you know, to do it. I was lucky. I was lucky. It was good duty. After a while, I thought, you know, and again, I have a great deal of respect for the foot soldier and the Marine and all those guys on the ground, you know, kick up the dust and crush the gravel, and everybody's got a job.
Well, and as you mentioned, you know, those people, you have to admire what they did day in and day out.
Oh, yeah.
But they depended on the air support, and they depended on the quartermaster back in the office support. So everyone who served was of value, but...
Everybody had a job.
Yeah, everybody had a job.
Everybody had a job, and it had to be done. And if I was in charge of something, like with the helicopter, if I wasn't really happy with the blade tracking, and I thought it could be better, I would tell the crew chief and the mechanic, I said, come on, let's go with me. And I would take him up on a test flight. And after a couple...
Then they understood what you were talking about.
it improved things.
Yes.
This is a picture of a Sikorsky H-19B model helicopter. I've talked about it before. This was taken over in Korea. We had just come back. And then I have another one down here that is doing what's called an auto rotation.
Oh, my.
What one does is you pretend to throttle and the engine is quit, and you glide down with nothing but the inertia and the lift by the blades alone. And the blades are symmetrical, so they produce lift going up or going down. And you keep it up, and then you do a big flare, and then you get about 3 feet off the ground, and you pull up on a control stick and just
set it down.
I don't know if that's me. I think that this is our tent we lived in Korea, and this is our houseboy Juan. I can't remember Juan something. And this is Wesley A. McCauley, a guy I flew with quite a bit. He was older than I. He was usually in charge. He was killed in a helicopter crash going after a crashed airplane in Japan. He was my best friend. And this is again in Korea.
Now, what area of Korea? Were you down near Seoul or were you up closer to the DMZ?
The closest we were was in Seoul at K-14 Gimpo, or a place called ASCOM City. They had a big hospital there. We were also at Osan-ni, K-55, in mid-Korea, and then we were also down at Kunsan, K-8, which is way in the southern part of Korea. and also at K2 Pusan. Mm-hmm. We used to ferry these helicopters from for duty over in Korea. We would ferry them from Japan to Korea. It was 122 miles, took about an hour and 55 minutes, and we did it over water that was in the 30s in the wintertime. But we had this same amphibious airplane I talked about before. He was circling around us, and they were squadron mates, and they promised that if we went down that they would pick us up in less than 10 minutes.
Now, did you do any medevac type work or strictly air rescue?
It was that I did a lot, quite a few medevacs. One person got shot in his chest here, and we had to drive him or fly him about from the southernmost base to the northernmost in Korea, and he lived. We had another young kid who got sucked into the intake of a jet as the pilot was on the ground running it up, and just took him into the intakes. The intake was in the nose of the, it was an F-86. And the pilot heard something, and they pulled the guy, this young kid out. We put him in the helicopter, and George and I flew him up to a hospital. And in flight, he stopped breathing, and this paramedic gave him a tracheostomy. Yeah, and the kid lived. So I never, thank goodness, I never carried a dead one.
So you learned to appreciate the helicopter.
Oh, I every time I see the Coast Guard go over, they go right over where I live. And if I know they're at the airport and I have time, I'll run out there and try to bum a ride, but it's not going to work.
Do you ever think about flying these new Apache Blackhawks and all the bells and whistles they have, huh?
I just last week delivered a sailboat by water from Sturgeon Bay to Milwaukee with an Apache helicopter pilot, Jerry White. He had 1,650 hours of combat in Vietnam in an Apache, two tours. He told me, and we had a lot of stories to talk about. It was a long trip, you know, like 29 hours or something. And he told me one time he came back with 138 bullet holes. I did not ask him if he was wounded, but from the description of where the bullets hit, he had to be had to be wounded. And it was very interesting talking to Jerry. We'd go down down below and let somebody else do the driving, and we would swap stories.
Now, you must have had night, did you have night vision goggles?
No.
You didn't have
no.
Any of the infrared.
The Air Force and the manual said that you are not to fly this in weather. I probably have about 3 hours in weather. One night I did put it in a cotton field, 3 miles short of the runway because we were out of control, and I recalled looking out the side window in the left seat. I was co-pilot. The pilot and the helicopter flies in the right seat. And I turned on the light at the right time, and the left main wheel took about this much off a cotton furrow. And we put it down there. And had to meet the base commander, and he said, "What happened?" And we told him. He said, "I'd go take a couple of days off."
Oh.
I was, we got caught in the fog. We were on a medical evac from England Air Force Base to Fort Polk, Louisiana, and dropped the patient off. He had an appendicitis rupture. And then we were following the highway back, and the weather started getting really stinky, so who was it? Let's see. I set it down in a farmer's field, and we walked to this farmer's house and knocked on the door and told him who we were, and of course he didn't, you know, he thought, "What's going on here?" And I called the base and I talked to the weather officer. I said, "We're stuck down in a field, we shut her down, and what's the weather like at the base?" And he said, "Just a moment, I'll go outside and I'll check." And he goes outside and he comes back and he says, "Well, I'm looking up at the moon and it looks good." Now, anytime you look at the moon through fog, you're going to see it. So this guy almost cost us a big problem.
Mm-hmm.
We had words, but...
Mm-hmm. Well, paying for a couple cotton plants as opposed to paying for a whole new helicopter, that was
I don't think
a pretty
farmer,
good trade.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it was... we flew it on instruments, and Clem Bailey could fly it for maybe 5 to 8 minutes, and then vertigo.
So was that the only time you had an unplanned landing?
No. An unplanned landing with a base commander on board once. A wing commander, Colonel Warfield. He wanted to get some flying time, and he wanted to fly in the helo to get his required monthly flying time. So I took him up, and we had smoke start coming out of the engine, so we put it down in a field, and it was a minor oil leak going out of cylinder, which was burning.
Mm-hmm.
So
The crew tries to play some pranks on the officers, or
yes, probably the best one was a flight engineer. He was a tech sergeant, and he never got any higher than a tech sergeant because he was dead serious, but when he got to altitude, he was known to pull practical jokes. Danny Seary, he was a flight engineer on a C-130 for me,
okay,
and also on a C-119, which is a twin-engine, propeller-driven, piston-driven airplane. Same thing for paratrooping and all that. Well, we had about, anywhere between 15 and 40 Navy guys in the cargo compartment on this old C-119. And it was bumpy and it was rough. And Danny asked if he could be excused for something. And I said, "What are you going to do?" He said, "I'll tell you later." So he went down and he looked at all these Navy people that were sitting on bucket seats with canvas and, of course, an aluminum frame. You've probably been there.
Not too comfortable.
No, they were getting a little queasy. And Danny comes down and he's rolling his eyes like this. And in the front of the airplane was a garbage can, you know, a 30-gallon size garbage can. And Danny kind of goes like he's going to retch, and he goes down and puts his head in the garbage can like he's barfing. And he's down there and he's opening up a can of vegetable soup. So then he puts the vegetable soup in a clear plastic bag. And then he finishes pretending that he's retching, holds up the plastic bag, and everyone knows what it looked like, and a bunch of the sailors got ill. Then he takes his bag of vegetable soup and drinks it. And that airplane was an absolute mess. That was Danny. Another time we had a bunch of Green Berets on board, and we were bringing them back, I think, from Greece. Yes, from Greece. And there were four people up front and two loadmasters in the back. And one by one, we put the airplane on autopilot, of course. And one by one, the crew came down from the flight deck and just sat down and started reading a magazine, Time or, Look or whatever. And then the next guy, and there were four people came down, and this last guy came down with a string in his hand, just holding on to the string and, doing things like moving it around a little bit. And one guy I noticed, I was sitting in the back also, of course, I noticed this one guy, I was really getting curious, and he was counting 1, 2, 3, 4. He knew there were four people up front, who's flying the airplane. So he came up to either me or one of the other crew and said, "You guys are all down here, who's flying the airplane?" And I said, well, that guy with the string over there. he went bananas, of course. It was the only serious stuff we really, or funny stuff we really did was at altitude.
Mm-hmm.
Anything near the ground, it was dead serious.
Mm-hmm.
I was landing the 130 one day, coming over Lake Michigan and Ladish, down in by Oak Creek area in Milwaukee, and for some reason, number three engine decided to get a fire warning light, and there's a jeweled light on right in the center of the instrument panel, about this big, and it's jeweled so that it really reflects like a Frenzel lens. And when that thing goes off, it gets about this big. And it went off, and we were 20 seconds from landing. So I always told the crew that I flew with, if anything happens and we're really busy, I'm just going to fly the airplane and you guys take care of the emergency. Don't even bother me. I'm just going to drive the airplane. And they shut it down. We landed. We didn't even have time to call the tower and tell them,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And we were queried later about why didn't you declare an emergency, and the ruling is if you have a big problem, there's a guy on the ground who can do absolutely nothing to help you, so why bother him to, mm-hmm. Solve the problem. And I always briefed if I was in charge that I would fly the airplane and somebody else take care of it, and if we have time.
The emergency takes the priority.
Yeah,
just, and then notify and it'll come later.
Technically, you're not supposed to do anything like that unless the aircraft commander says, okay, shut down number three, go through the bold list procedures, and blah, 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 mm-hmm. blah, blah. Mm-hmm. And there's about, you have to memorize all these steps.
Mm-hmm.
Like fire engine control handle pulled, and the fire bottle pushed, and blah, 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 mm-hmm. and all this stuff. But in something like that, mm-hmm. That was my philosophy,
yeah.
and my crew knew that.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Now you said you showed us pictures living in tents in Korea. Did you have USO shows come through at that time, or?
Yes, we had Jane Russell.
Oh, that's pretty.
We had Jane Russell come over to Korea with Johnny Grant's band, and I really remember these so well, and they put on a show in an old auditorium, and the guys started stomping their feet so much and clapping and screaming when they were on the stage singing and dancing that all the dust started come out of the ceiling, and they had to stop the show because they were afraid the building, I think, was going to collapse. And then Rita Moreno was over there.
Oh, you saw some good ones. Did she dance for you then, or just sing?
No. But Kathy Grant, who married Bing Crosby,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
was over there, and you had Squadron Morale jackets. We had red, gray, and white plaid. Some squadrons had, the troop carrier squadrons had blue or brown or gray, and we had these things they call the horse blanket. We were probably the laughing stock, and I have a picture of this at home. Mm-hmm. So we voted Miss Kathy Grant Miss Air Rescue of 1956. So she came and sat with us, mm-hmm. and danced with a lot of the guys and blah, blah, blah. And she was very nice.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
She was very nice. And there was Peggy somebody who my wife went to high school with, also in the entourage.
Mm-hmm.
That was the only two I recall.
So Bob wasn't...
Oh no, Bob Hope was not there.
Okay.
And I'm not sure when he was married to Kathy Grant in 1956.
Bing.
Yeah.
Bing Crosby.
Who'd I say?
Oh, I was asking if Bob Hope had been with the shows.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
I never saw Bob Hope, mm-hmm. Jane Russell.
But that was a pretty big star to see Jane.
Yeah, everybody was there taking pictures. Mm-hmm. I have some pictures somewhere of them performing, and then in Japan, they always had USO people coming through,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And they would perform at the club, mm-hmm. of course, or an auditorium where everyone, mm-hmm. got to, and usually they did it in a hangar.
Mm-hmm.
so that a lot of people could get in there.
Mm-hmm. Now, were you married while you were on active duty those 5 years? And
Yes, I got married in December 26th of 1954. So I was married when I was in flying school.
Mm-hmm.
And my instructor advised me totally against it. He says, you don't need any distractions, you don't need anything, you better just concentrate on what you're doing here and learning to fly. And I said, okay. But I went there and I came back home and I thought, oh golly, I gotta tell this guy. And of course he saw my ring. He didn't say anything.
Mm-hmm. So it sounds like you were overseas for a lot of your active duty time.
It was about almost close to 15 months. I did take a twin engine C-119 to Europe probably 4 times, hauling trash or mm-hmm. stuff.
Now, you mentioned hauling trash before. Do you mean literally trash, garbage, or?
No, trash hauling is anything from ammunition to TP, to troops, to Navy people, to anything. It was just a saying that the C-130 is a trash hauler.
So it's a term of endearment, huh?
A term of endearment, yeah. They would, Vietnam, they would carry these, maybe Laddie remembers, they would carry these huge rubber gasoline, probably with 100 gallons,
mm-hmm.
and of course it was round, because that's the best way to secure
like
a liquid.
Yeah.
And they would take these and drop them in for jet fuel or truck fuel, mm-hmm. or Jeep or whatever. So it was all just called trash hauling. We didn't say that around the crew.
Mm-hmm.
We tried to comfort the paratroopers who were doing their first jump.
Mm-hmm.
Some guys had a sadistic streak, I think, because if I wasn't in charge, they would just go down there and they would tell all kinds of terrible things. And like, you know, if we crash, this is what you better do, and if you don't, you're gonna die. And I took a more passive approach.
Mm-hmm.
I thought those poor guys are going to jump out of this perfectly good running airplane. I never did, and I would never want to.
Now, was there any inner service ribbing that would go on there? Because it sounds like you carried, you know, Army and Navy and Marines. And,
oh, yeah.
So would you kind of give them a hard time about things?
Oh, yeah. I went into a Marine base one time and told them we had a 6 o'clock takeoff. This was for it was down in San Antonio for the generals, the 26 of them. And we didn't have enough fuel, but we told them the night before we needed the X number of 1,000 pounds. And it was a Marine Corps base that we first went to, I think. Yes, it was a Marine Corps base. And tower was closed, base operations was closed, we couldn't file a flight plan, we had to do that in the air, the generals were coming out, and you know, something had to be done. So I told Wayne Vocek, a master sergeant, I said, go get that gas truck and give me 20,000 pounds of fuel. He says, do you really want me? I said, what choice do we have? So he went and got in there and filled all the paperwork and left it in the truck, took our 20,000 whatever pounds. And the next thing I did when I got to the next base and we dropped off the generals was I called my boss in Milwaukee and I told him what I did, why I did it, and what was the alternatives. And this guy would say, well, why didn't you? And I, you know, had an answer. I thought I had an answer for him. And of course, the Marines called him up and they said, you know, blah, 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 blah. Why did you do that? And then this colonel that I worked for just started rat-a-tat-tatting at them and saying, why didn't you have something out there? Did he call you? Why wasn't the tower open? There were 26 generals coming. What's the matter with you? What kind of operation you run down there? And of course, I preempted him, so.
He was ready.
When I got back to Milwaukee, he'd say, Jim, just keep letting me know if you do something like this so I have some ammunition back. And he always protected me. Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. We only have about 2 minutes of tape left.
Okay.
Can you do a little wrap up? You know, thank you for doing so.
Sure.
And so, and ask him if he has a short thought for the century or something as a result of his experience, maybe.
Okay.
I have one more thing to show, too.
Okay, let's go ahead and do that then, if you would, please.
What is that?
Well, yeah, ask me if I have any, I don't know, any badges to show.
Oh, okay. You ready? Well, unfortunately, we've come to the end of our time here for sharing your experiences with us, Jim. Is there anything else you had brought along to show? Any badges, medals that you'd like to share?
Yes, I'm wearing them right now.
You are?
Yes.
I saw your American flag. Oh my. Well, now open that up so everyone can see. So you retired as a lieutenant colonel.
Yeah, I retired as a lieutenant colonel. I got these two awards. I don't recall what for. This is my Sikorsky Winged S, which is my most cherished item mm-hmm. from that rescue. When you start out in the Air Force, you start out with what they call slick wings. There's nothing
okay.
on them. You get 5 years and you get 1,500 hours and they give you a star.
Mm-hmm.
That means you know a little more information. When you get 15 years and 3,000 hours, then they put a wreath around the star. And then you're a command pilot.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Then you can not even be part of the crew and recommend that things be done, but mm-hmm. I never did that.
Mm-hmm.
So I just, I put these on.
Yep, you earned them. And so looking back on your career and your time in the military with the Air Force, is there anything that you kind of take away as something that served you in life, any kind of message to live by, or?
Yes. Always do what you're told, although in the service you do what you're told or you have a problem. The Air Force taught me redundancy. If you lose one engine, what are you going to do if you lose the second engine?
Mm-hmm.
What are you going to do if the gear doesn't come down the first time? Well, there's 7 ways to drop a gear on that thing.
Mm-hmm.
Redundancy, which I use today. I go out on Lake Michigan, I have 2 radios. I have all kinds of safety equipment. They teach you what if.
Mm-hmm.
And it was interesting on this trip to Milwaukee with this Cobra pilot, he thought exactly as I did.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it was, he had 4 radios. And he had backup for everything, and everything was what if. What if the fog gets worse? What if this happens? What are we going to do?
Mm-hmm.
And I guess, I don't guess, I am a patriot. I fly my flag 24/7, mm-hmm. lit at night. I have the black ribbon on it, because I can't lower it.
Mm-hmm.
So I follow all the rules, and I consider myself a patriot. And I wouldn't give up my years in the military for mm-hmm. for anything. I thoroughly enjoyed it, active duty and also reserve, because reserve, I was home every night during the week.
Well, Jim, I tell you, the community of Sevastopol is very glad that you retired here
mm-hmm.
and want to thank you very much for your time with us here today, but especially want to thank you for your service. And we appreciate your giving us your time here today. So on behalf of the Sevastopol Historical Society, thank you very much and have a good day.
Thank you, and you too.
Thanks.